Right. Well, thank you, Anjali. And thank you for your being here and arranging these life-saving lunchtime readings, which are just wonderful. And I've already registered for Goblin Market next week. And I'd like to start by reading a poem from the first collection, Swimming Through Marble. So I just want to change something on my screen because I'm not seeing well. Hang on. So it's called Master of Gossamer. And here we go. Oh, big scary spider in a corner of the step. Why do you cower there behind a weed? Don't you know how much in awe of you we are? The way you float from egg to sticky leaf, swing across the bush, fly from tree to tree, abseil lightly down the highest walls. We too want to dance tightrope across the moon, drop from an empty sky, weave larders in the air. Only when you stand defiant in the white expanse of the bathtub are you vulnerable. Some of your eyes on the plug hole, some on the tap, but most on the screaming giant who might transfer you to the window from where you could lasso the wind. And the second one is from Lightfalls, which is the second collection. Thank you, Helen. It's called Irretrievable. I set up my angels. Demons knock them over in play. Of all the broken pieces, some burnish, some crack my heart. Broken angels are my coat of dust. Demons warm my hands. Fallen from the pinioned host, they ache to make amends. Tableau. Lovers in a garden, feathered serpents asleep in the trees, fermenting apples on the altar, honey on the knife. And the next poem will be published by Beyond Words in June. It's called They Line Her Route, leaning against shop windows, smoking in porches and doorways, flipping coins and following her passage with cartoon eyes, free falling into step beside her, giggling banal invitations into her right ear, left shoulder. Stomach tight and churning, she click-clicks high-stepping, low acceleration, knowing haste will goad the hunters down the one-track road, where they come together to trip her into rough grass, old beer cans, bottles, lacy rags, broken shoes running as fast as blood. And this is a very recent poem, Beyond the Boardwalk. Lots of places other than here in answer to, do we want to go elsewhere? They were so proud of the new boardwalk, lit up by garlands and strands of light bulbs, with railings and trash cans and benches, built over the exquisite silver sands, studded with shells and starfish, before the ocean's shifting tideline. But they wouldn't come with us after dark. None of the men wanted to walk with us on the boards in the tropical sea-filled night, where beyond the electric illumination, the moon breathed on the sea and the sea breathed at the moon. So we three girls gathered our skirts and set out on the illuminated way, where we met no bodies or villains, no druggies or flaneurs, no lechers, no leering fools, no one at all. But lovers, down on the moonlit sands, were kissing the skin of the dark, caressing the heaving sea, licking the salt of the sea, letting the sea lick their feet, wetting their hands in the sea, giving themselves to the sea, letting the ocean enter them. All along the coast, they were drowning in the midnight sea. The next poem was commended in the 2020 Ware competition. It's called Barely Marked. Even in the desert, there is succor. In a small camp somewhere, it is rumored they have belladonna. She treks through dark and starless heat till she sees a distant flicker of light. Hope comes upon her. Two only round the little fire gilding the circle. She desires to enter the glow. They share with her mint tea and dates, sporadic silence while she waits to ask them how to cure a fever mounting still in one with no strength to be well in ailing limbs. They give her the potion, then she hurries back into the desert, carefully carries it in her palms. In the room, she finds his face a blur of sweat, his failing speech is slurred, deprived of sense. She puts cupped water to his lips to cool his tongue, so hard to sip through air this dense. She holds him as he tries to swallow, then lays his head back on the pillow. He fades to sleep. She watches as his breathing calms his restlessness. He shifts his arms till shallow deepens. Now he lies quiet. She dims the lamp, sets out once more to find the camp and kiss the hands. It is barely marked by a scatter of ash, circled around a blackened bush. No footprints in the sand. And this next one was published last year in the Blue Nib. My aunt lit a cigarette. She said, "Get me out of here. I can't fit inside my own home. Let's go to the middle of the ocean. Out there, surrounded by the deep blue, the seabed shallows up into a circle of turquoise. We can walk around the edge of the depths, lie on our backs, soak in the colours." My aunt lit a cigarette and haggled with the boatman who putt-putted us past curious turtles and confetti beneath the ripples. We were alone, three people mid-ocean, seabirds, fish. The boat idled and I slid into liquid sky, floated to the edge and swam beyond it. Still in the boat, my aunt lit a cigarette. "Did you know your grandmother shot a man? She was threatened by a mob. It was hushed up." Casually, she flicked her ash over the bombshell and I climbed back into the boat. When we left, the boatman gave me a conch. It sits in my garden still, the delicate pink interior dulled by the calc of London rain. And this is called Breakfast at the Beach Cafe. They come in silhouetted against the light, shouldering their Uzis, approach the counter through the jumbled tables and ask for breakfast. I open the heavy fridge doors, take out a plastic bag of milk, put it in its plastic jug and clip off the tip. Coffee, tea, bread, olives, tomatoes, gherkins, cheese, fresh white, processed yellow. Everything on a metal tray slid across in exchange for coins and conversation. I pour myself coffee, speaking into the light beyond the breakfasting soldiers, towards the corals, the salt glint of hot air, the endless wind. Feel myself diving down amongst seagrass, sea stars, the startled, beautiful fish. I say goodbye, collect the remnants, take them to the sink, plunge my hands into the water. I just finished with, I've got two short ones to finish with, and the first is called Tabernacled. If you hold my hands, how will I catch the falling? If I close my eyes, will you assume the darkness? If you can't hear me, should I rehearse the song? If I fall silent, will you complete my words? If you confess me, will I become worth saving? If I disagree, will you want me disfigured? If you turn your back, can I climb on your shoulders? If I hold your hands, how will you catch the falling? And finally, this is one also from the second Lightfalls collection. It's called And So I Pray, and this is the last one, I promise you. And so I pray. Peril paints the horizon and thuds into the ground while I butter my toast. My soulmates slide to the edge of life. I have no shield to hold over the beloved. No echo returns from the future. Then the sun turns a dirty London corner and conjures a luminous cityscape from cracks in the concrete. Neglected crannies fill with incandescent dust. Radiance flickers over unsettled faces. So I pray to give the dead the love they deserved, to inhabit, like a hoverfly, my own speck of heaven, for my cat to hurry slowly towards me, my man to touch me for no reason, for the ocean, for the air, for the restoration of love. Thank you.